My dear friends, look at this painting. It's not just colors and strokes. It's my memory of our trip to Lake Tahoe last year, all wrapped up in the chill charm of winter brought to life today with watercolors. We've traveled to Lake Tahoe last year, and it seemed like every snowy peak and tall pine held a story. I thought I needed to paint one of these scenes to keep these precious memories in my heart. Alright, let's get started. Here is my trusty old tin palette. It's like an old friend, full of memories and ready for more. I'm taking out these old colors, they've done their part. It's kind of like tidying up an old room, making space for something new and exciting. Today we're adding cobalt violet and sap green. I just felt like these two colors could add life and energy to our winter scene. Whether you're here to paint along with me or just to watch and relax, it is so good to have you here. If you're not painting, why not grab a warm cup of tea or coffee? Get cozy, because we're about to transform a blank piece of paper into a winter scene in Lake Tahoe. For this painting, I chose 140-pound rough watercolor paper for its texture, just right for capturing the uneven, playful surfaces of snowbanks like those I saw in Lake Tahoe. A folded cotton towel, two jars of clean water, and the following brushes. Size 12 synthetic round brush, a real multitasker. It is great for covering large areas and can still whip out those fine lines when needed. I took out two small all-purpose calligraphy brushes. They're my to-go for just about everything. They can make a world of strokes. It's always fun to see what they'll do next. The little size 2 liner brush will be perfect for the delicate tree branches and those tiny details that bring a scene to life. Size 2 round brush has been with me for years. It is used primarily for masking fluid. You'll see me apply thin strokes of masking fluid in a little bit. I'm not sure yet if I'll use size 3 mop brush today, but I like to have it close by. It is great for smooth, even washes. Might come in handy for those vast snowy scenes. And finally, a 3B pencil to lay loose outlines of the scene. You may be wondering about the colors we'll use for this painting. We'll get to those in a little bit. But first, let's start with sketching out our scene. I often use 3B pencil. It is soft enough to leave a gentle mark, but firm enough to give some control. We're not going for perfection here, just a loose outline to guide our painting. You can use a pencil of your preference. First, we'll slightly sketch the contours of Lake Tahoe's landscape. The distant snowy mountain peaks, beautiful rock formations, that is a highlight of Sun Harbor Beach, the rolling snowbanks, and just a slight vertical lines to map out the towering pines. As some of you may know, I do not aim for a realistic rendering of a scene. Rather, it is a mental image and a feeling I carry from visiting Sun Harbor Beach in winter. This step is about getting a feel for the scene, imagining how the elements fit together before the watercolors bring them to life. If you'd like to use my sketch, feel free to take it in the video description below. Let's get to the next step, masking fluid application. Masking gum will help us preserve the whites of the paper for those crisp snowy caps and foreground snowbanks. I prefer using Pebeo drawing gum. It's got a slight tint, making it easier to see where I have applied it on the paper. Really handy for keeping track of our snow areas. Also, I chose to use the old size 2 round brush for the job. Masking fluid can be tough on the brushes, so to protect it, I give it a quick coat with a bar of soap before dipping it into the fluid. The soap forms a protective layer, stopping the masking fluid from clinging to the bristles. Gently, we'll apply the fluid where we want our brightest whites. Think about the light hitting those snowy tops and banks. Just a few marks here and there, and we are setting the stage for those beautiful snowy areas. After applying the masking fluid, it's important to let it dry completely. I avoid using a hairdryer at this stage, as it can melt the gum instead of drying it, and we definitely don't want to do that. The other colors I will be using in this painting are cobalt violet, alizarin crimson, yellow ochre, sap green, iris green, and burnt sienna. I'll talk more about these colors as our painting progresses. What I just did now is soak the paper with water using the mop brush. I knew it will be useful for this exact task. This is key for creating that soft, dreamy look in our sky. The wet-on-wet technique is perfect for achieving those smooth blended washes. The reason I use the size 3 mop brush here is because it holds a good amount of pigment, which is just what I need for the sky. Now watch as I loosely apply the colors from top to bottom. I'm careful not to bring the saturated pigment too far down to the horizon. The idea is to create a sense of depth. Less pigment and more water towards the horizon line will give us that distant sky look, but closer to us, up the sky, will have more color. I used a mix of cobalt blue, ultramarine, and a bit of cobalt violet for the upper part of the sky. Each stroke adds to the mood, building a sky that's alive with color. I've switched to my size 12 round brush, perfect for shaping the mountain peaks. Watch how I guide the wet pigment, defining the mountain's shadowy areas. We are avoiding any pulling of the base of the sky. That's crucial for a smooth, natural look where sky and mountains meet. With this cool blue mix, I'm bringing the rugged, snow-covered sides of the mountains to life. Each stroke is a decision on where the shadows fall, shaping the mountains right before our eyes. We're adding depth and form for these distant peaks, capturing the essence of Tahoe Basin. Now let's welcome a couple of new colors to our palette, burnt sienna and yellow ochre. These earthy hues are going to be key for the next part of our scene. I will be using yellow ochre to bring out the warmth in our rocky formations and the glow of pine trees in the sun. It's a color that really captures that natural feel. In burnt sienna, I will use it for creating darks and define the trunks and branches of our pine trees, adding a touch of realism and depth to their foliage. With these colors, we'll add layers and textures, creating a balance between the cool blues of the sky, mountains and the lake, with the warmth of the rocky formations and the foliage. Now we are moving on to lake and rocks, using the same wet-on-wet technique we started with. Just like before, I am pre-wetting the paper. It's all about setting the stage for the pigments to blend seamlessly. I'll be honest, it's taken me years to get the hang of this technique. Even now, it can be a bit unpredictable deciding exactly when to drop the pigment onto the wet surface. The trick is to let the water soak just enough into the paper so it's ready to mingle with the paint. And here's another tip, make sure your brush is loaded with pigment, but it's not overly wet with water. It's a delicate balance, but when you get it right, the colors flow into each other, creating this beautiful natural blend. When you apply first wash, you don't have to worry too much when the colors mix like this. This dance of color will help your work look seamless and natural. A couple of more things to note as we work on the surface of the lake and rocks. First, I keep my paper pad at an angle. It keeps the pigments flow downwards, creating a more dynamic look without the pooling of pigments and water in one spot. Pooling can lead to those unwanted cauliflower blooms. See how tilting the paper just a bit helps the water and color move naturally downwards. Now watch this, I'm mixing ultramarine blue with burnt sienna straight out of the pans without adding too much water. This thick dark mix is great for defining the shadows on our rocks, and it gives us rich gray color that really adds depth and texture to those shadow areas. Up next is a step that's totally optional, and it's all about experimenting. I've always been curious about using cling wrap on rough watercolor paper, even though I had a hunch it might not work as well as on smoother surfaces. And guess what? I tried it and it confirmed my belief. So if you are following along, feel free to skip this part if you want. The cling wrap technique can be really fun. It's used to create abstract, textured shapes that can mimic the look of rocky surfaces. If you are working on smoother paper or just feeling adventurous, give it a try. You might be surprised by the unique patterns and effects it creates. If you do decide to use cling wrap, there's a little trick to it. The key is not to fiddle with it too much once it's on the wet surface. Just lay it down gently and let it sit. It's tempting to keep adjusting it, but trust me, less is more here. After placing the wrap, the hardest part is waiting. We need to let the surface dry completely. Before we can see the pattern, it helped to create. Let's shift our focus to the distant pine forests, covering the foothills of our mountains. For this, we are aiming for cool grayish-green tones, the kind that help us to create a feel of faraway trees. I am starting with yellow ochre as our base. It's an earthy yellow color, but to capture that distant cool feel, I'm adding in more ultramarine blue. This mix gradually shifts from a warm yellow to a cooler, more subdued green. As I apply this mix, I imagine this pine forest from afar, softly blanketed in winter's embrace. The cooler tone helps them sit back in the painting, giving a sense of depth and distance. I'm using calligraphy brush here, lightly sprayed to create those abstract shapes of pine trees. This technique gives us a soft look, suggesting trees that are far away. I'm being careful here though. It is easy to get carried away, and we want to hint at the trees, not to spell them out completely. Now, to bring the whole scene together, I'm adding touches of reflected cobalt violet. This adds a unifying tone to our atmosphere, tying the sky to the land. And just over here, on the advancing mountain to the right, I will add more yellow ochre. It brings a touch of warmth to the scene, helping this part of the mountain come forward a bit more in our painting. I feel like now is the time to remove the masking gum. I'm gently feeling the paper to see how dry it is. This part needs a bit of patience and a light touch. Before I begin, I make absolutely sure the pigments are fully dry. If we rush and the paint is still wet, we risk disturbing those layers of color. And here we go, the masking fluid is gone from top of our rocky formations. This is always a satisfying moment. We are revealing the bright whites we preserved beforehand. As I work on defining the shadow sides of the rock and reflections with the mix of ultramarine blue, alizarin crimson and burnt sienna, I can't help but think back to my visit to Lake Tahoe in winter. It's a mesmerizing place, truly a winter wonderland. Even with my physical limitations, just being there was a gift. I use crutches and scooter to get around, and while that means I can't join in on all the snow activities, there is still so much to enjoy there. I remember one day we were at the cross-country skiing spot. That's when I saw something truly amazing. There was this person who arrived in a wheelchair but instead of wheels, it had skis. It was incredible to see. Her inability to walk didn't stop her from enjoying the winter, gliding among the pine trees. I wasn't equipped to ski like her, but seeing her, my mindset shifted. I thought, maybe I can ski too, if I set my mind to it. It was a powerful reminder that our physical challenges don't define what we can enjoy or achieve. Some of you may know that I have a physical disability that makes walking difficult, but I love the outdoors and I'm determined to keep exploring, to keep experiencing places like Lake Tahoe, despite any challenges. I think it's about finding ways to be part of the beauty and adventure that beautiful nature offers to us every day. Carrying the spirit of resilience and possibility from that inspiring moment back to our painting. Now we're focusing on the pine trees that stand tall on the rocky terrain of St. Harbor Beach. I noticed that on a sunny days, these trees are a kaleidoscope of colors. There are yellows, browns, and a spectrum of greens dancing on the light. Capturing this vibrant life is my goal. I'm using my calligraphy and liner brushes for this. They are perfect for the kind of detailed work these trees need. Our palette will include yellow ocher for the warmth, ultramarine blue to mix green with, forest green for shadow areas, and sap green for those natural greens. And just a touch of burnt sienna and burnt umber to define the tree trunks and branches. Each color plays its part in bringing these trees to life, reflecting the hues I saw that sunlit day at Lake Tahoe. As I work on these pine trees, you'll notice I'm not getting caught up in painting every single pine needle or branch. Instead, it's about placing marks of color, creating an impression of the trees. I drew the inspiration from seeing many works of impressionists. They had this beautiful way of capturing nature, not by detailing every aspect, but by focusing on the play of light and color. What I love about this loose approach is how it creates an image that's alive with light and life. I feel like as these colors come together, they start to form a lively picture of the pines, bathed in sunlight, just as I remember them at Lake Tahoe. You may have noticed that I sped up the video here. I wanted to make sure you could see every part of the painting process without missing a single stroke. But don't worry, you're not missing out on the details. If you want to see this section at a slower pace, please feel free to come back to this video and slow down the playback. Most video players have settings that let you adjust the speed, and this way you can rewatch each step and technique as it unfolds. As we move to the next phase of our painting, it is time to give more life to our lake, adding reflections that capture the beauty of the snowy peaks, rocky formations, and pine trees. But before we start doing it, it is important that our paper is completely dry. First, I pre-wetted the paper. We want the reflections to blend smoothly, capturing the serene essence of Lake Tahoe. Now, with the brush loaded with cinereous blue, I'm ready to paint those reflections. I feel like this color is perfect for mimicking the tranquil hues of the lake. As I apply it, you'll see the reflections begin to take shape, mirroring the beauty of our landscape above. It's a delicate dance of color and water, creating a mirror-like effect that brings a sense of calm and depth to our painting. While the paper is still wet, it is the ideal time to add in more colors for our reflections. We want to be conscious about the layering a lot of colors at this stage and not to overdo it. Too much colors and we may risk muddying the area. I am bringing in some cobalt violet now, giving a hint of those cool shadowy reflections, then a dark mix of burnt sienna and ultramarine blue to mirror the rocky formations. And for the reflection of alpine trees, I'm using a dark green mix with just a few drops of yellow ochre. These colors add depth and richness to our lake. See how I'm keeping my lines soft and fluid here? As soon as they start getting too defined, it's time to pause. If we keep going, we end up with unwanted blooms or runs. Sometimes I use a water spritzer to keep the canvas wet, but this time I'm going without it. I'm watching the paper closely, and when it loses the sheen of water, that's my clue to stop, letting it dry naturally as part of the process, allowing each layer to settle on their own time. Now that our paper is dry, I'm carefully removing the rest of the masking gum. We are revealing those snow banks and snow caps on rocks. It's time to bring them to life with color. When I first started with watercolors, I was absolutely captivated by how artists paint snow. It's fascinating how something as simple and white as snow can be filled with so many colors and shades. I remember seeing Claude Monet, the magpie. The way he captured snow, it was breathtaking. It made me want to explore and understand the colors of snow in my work. And now, here's my take on it. For the snowbanks, I first defined the shadow areas with my pencil, then pre-wetted the paper, before proceeding with the underpainting of cobalt violet and alizarin crimson. This lays down a subtle base color. Then I layer a mix of cobalt blue, ultramarine blue, and alizarin crimson on top. This combination will help us build those realistic shadows in the snow. For the deepest shadow areas, I'll use a more concentrated mix of alizarin crimson and ultramarine blue. It's all about creating depth and dimension, showing how even the purest white snow is full of life and varying hues. Paper is still damp with the first layers of snow, I'm adding touches of pure ultramarine blue. This will deepen the shadows, giving more dimensions to the snow. And here's a spontaneous twist I thought of while I painted the snow, adding coarse grain salt to the snowbanks. This isn't necessary, but it's fun, creative experiment. If you like the snow as it is, feel free to leave it like that. But if you're curious, the salt can add an abstract pattern to the painting. The trick with salt is about timing. Apply it while the paper is starting to lose its sheen. The salt interacts with the watercolors, creating these unique textures that almost mimic the natural sparkle of snow. Just let it sit there until everything is completely dry. It's one of those happy little surprises that watercolors offer. You never quite know what you'll get, but it's always a delightful discovery. I had visitors in my home while I painted the scene, and you can hear Eddie excited to interact with them. As I near the completion of this painting of Lake Tahoe in winter, I find myself filled with gratitude. It's not just about finishing this painting, it's about what it represents. Despite challenges, I made it to Lake Tahoe last winter. I even took a few steps on those slippery trails, thanks to the support of my family and friends, and the encouragement of people I've met there. Every stroke felt like a tribute to those moments of pure beauty in nature, in human spirit, and in the warmth of the community. These mountains of California, they are my purest joy and love. They are a reminder of the beauty and strength we find in the world and in each other. And to each and every one of you watching, I can't thank you enough. Your love, support, and interest in what I share here make our community thrive. It's because of you that this journey is so fulfilling to me. As I add this last few touches, I want you to know that your presence here means the world to me. Thank you for being the part of this artistic journey, for helping our community grow. I couldn't be happier to share this experience with you all, my dear friends. If you've enjoyed this journey through watercolors and are eager to learn more, I've got plenty more for you. Feel free to check out my watercolor basics tutorial, and they are great for everyone looking to strengthen their watercolor skills. And for more personal touch, take a look at my watercolor stories playlist. Here I share my personal stories, the inspirations behind my paintings, and the little moments of life that make their way into my paintings. It's a mix of art and heart, and I'd love for you to join me there. Now, as we come to the final touches of our Lake Tahoe painting, I decided to apply thin strokes of cinereous blue to add a hint of ripples on the lake surface. I thought they could bring a sense of movement on the water. With each such stroke, we are suggesting the calm of the day. And finally, I decided to pull out some white gouache to suggest sparkling light on the water surface. With the white gouache, we are going to dot in those sparkles of sunlight, giving life and light to our scene. And with those final touches, our Lake Tahoe winter scene comes to a close. I had a wonderful time painting this painting, and I hope it's brought as much joy to you as it has to me. Before I go, I want to wish you all the joy of creativity. Keep exploring, keep painting, and most importantly, keep enjoying every moment of it. Your artistic journey is unique and beautiful, and I'm so grateful to be part of it. Please share your final works with me and your friends and families. I can't wait to see what you all created. I'll see you in my next videos. Until next time, happy painting!